That is the way in which you give another, you give that memory another life. Now coming to how do ideas and concepts inform one's work? I mean, an artist is not just a painter, even a painter is not just a painter. He reads, he thinks, you know, you see films, you do so many other things. And all these things will affect, will seep into your work in one way or the other. So one of the things that I was interested in was science fiction, especially the ideas of time travel. So at a certain point, I used to read a lot of that and imagine various fantastic things. And I made a set of drawings about encountering people from the past, which is actually what one does when one is looking at classical art. So when one is looking at portraits, one is when Rembrandt, of course, but any other, you know, any other head from ancient times, one is actually going, bringing that person from whichever century, right up to face to face with you. So you're bringing that person up and then projecting into the future. What would that be? You know, all, I mean, film, of course, does that in so much more effective ways. But that is the kind of thing one is interested in. And I'll read a small line that Giv Patel had written about these works. They are individual, there are about 14 of these, which were later made into prints. So they were heads from art history, and they were like imagined heads. Or so what Giv has written is, there is a quiet shuttling between the tenses or unexpected combinations of them, an intimation of an existence with fluid boundaries. So in a very small, short space, Giv expresses the sentiment of this time travel. I mean, why is one interested in time travel? The idea that traveling in space and then traveling in time for us, the attraction of it is this kind of shuttling between tenses. Then in 2014, Jitish was curating Kochi Biennale, and he sent this very lovely curatorial note about exploration in the world. And I got to thinking about my earlier interest in science fiction and things like that. And two things came together in my mind. Two things that seem to be basic to human history, and it seems not just human history, but history of all species. One is migration, which is exploration, migration, moving away. And one is settling down. So we all want to settle down somewhere, build cities, build civilizations, and at the same time, we also want to move away. We want to move to other places. We want to discover other places. So this, what is the relationship between these two things? And I was reading, and I came across some lovely texts. So I'll show you that this is a triptych with three sections. The first one is obviously about migration, either forced migration here. It seems forced. There's something happening in that village, probably someone bombing it. There are warships in the Gulf. There's that black moon. There's also that image of the first African woman moving out off. And then there is that totem, which is a borrowing from Jyoti Basu's work. There's another borrowing from Jyoti Basu's work, who I think is one of the great kind of visionary artists that we have. So I'd like to read the passage here, which is on top, which you can't see, or maybe you just can, but I'll read it out to you. It's a poem, it's a part of a poem by Ruth Padell. You go because the cold is coming. Spring is coming. Soldiers are coming. Plague, flood, an ice age, a new religion, a new idea. You go because the world rotates, because the world is changing and you have lost the key. You go because you have the kingdom of heaven in your heart and the kingdom of hell has taken over someone else's heart. So that is Ruth Padell about migration. She, you know, writes about bird migration, animal migration, and human migrations. The second, the central, is of course Peter Bruegel's Tower of Babel, and on it is Tatlin's monument to the Third International. This was a monument that was not built, but the proposal for this monument Tatlin had built, Third International. So both these, to my mind, are statements about man's power over nature. So both the Tower of Babel and Tatlin's Tower was saying that man has now arrived, he can be God. He can do what he wants. He can change the world. That was the dream of the Third International. And above it is a passage from the Genesis. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language. And this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all earth. So the history of migration in the Genesis is this almost evil idea that these people are coming together. Now they think they can do anything they want. So let us confound their language. Let them not understand each other. So it's like a reflection of what happens today. It's like a reflection of what happens through history. And then the third panel, futuristic, again, Jyoti Basu's city at the bottom. And there are three ideas of science which don't agree with each other. The most optimistic is Carl Sagan in Cosmos. Many of you must have seen the magnificent 14-part series. Now, Carl Sagan believes we take off into the cosmos. No, sorry. If we were to receive a radio message from an extraterrestrial civilization, how could it be understood? We believe all the technical civilizations in the cosmos, no matter how different they are, must have one language in common. And the language of science, that is the language of science and mathematics. The laws of nature are everywhere the same. This belief of science that mathematics is same for any intelligence. Against this is the more romantic Stanislaw Lem, the writer of Solaris, who says, we take off into the cosmos ready for anything, but we simply want to extend the boundaries of Earth to the frontiers of the cosmos. We have no need for other worlds. We need mirrors. We don't know what to do with other worlds. We are searching for an ideal image of our own world. So here are two conflicting views of what is possible in exploration. And there's Thomas Kuhn, whose Structure of Scientific Revolutions more or less changed the paradigm of how to understand scientific revolutions, says, the question, what must the world be like in order that man may know it, is as old as science itself and remains unanswered. we don't know, essentially. We know as much as we can practically do. We know what we can do with the world, but what it is, he says, and what it must be so that we understand it is something that cannot be answered. Well, these are, I'm sorry that I've kind of been quoting so much, but let me go back to the full image. There is so much ideation here, and how do I make a painting out of that? So what I do ultimately is a kind of allegory of migration and settling down, of understanding language and of confounding language. Are we in this together? Is it possible to kind of, you know, have civilization, human civilization move on, have the genes there emerging from the depths of the sea, go into space and, you know, start civilizations on other planets, etc., etc. It's a kind of allegory of evolution in a sense. So with all this reading and with all this heavyweight kind of ideation, one does a painting hoping that there is some connection between the imagery and the ideas. Another allegorical work, very different from the earlier one. This image of an artist standing naked with a bleeding heart in one hand and a brush in the other hand, this image came to me like in my mind, and I kept putting it off for a long time because this is not the kind of image that I wanted to paint. You know, it's not the kind of thing that I do. As you said, everyday life, that is the stuff that I work with. But it kept repeating, it kept kind of coming back. So then I started thinking about it, and I realized that it refers to the kind of tragic, romantic tradition of art, which is to some extent today discredited. The idea of an artist as an outsider, as a visionary, has gone a little outside. And we think of the artist more as a professional today, who has his rightful place in society. But this image, again, I might just read a little bit that I had written about it. I'll just describe what is there for you, that this naked artist, as I said, and then on the right, Leonardo's Virgin of the Rocks, part of it, and on the left is a Persian painting by Akamirak, and the painting has a very beautiful title, given later, of course, but it's beautiful. It's called Noshirwan, Listening to the Owls in the Ruined Palace. What I was attracted to was the rocks. So the rocks were the first thing that occurred to me along with this image. This image, as an outsider, a visionary, outside society, so what I've written about it is this: the artist figure is divided in half by the light falling on it. Bright and dark sides will forever coexist in him. He is a creature of doubt. He stands a tormented and undecided witness to his own condition. Just as the two old masters whose work he claims surely stood witness to theirs. But he is witness also to the transcendent beauty of their creations, and it is his torment that has led him to the vision of this beauty. This is the restitution for his pain, and this is the romantic vision revisited. So one felt at that time that it's that kind of tragic romanticism is something that one has to hold on to. Okay, so now paintings that are about painting. thinking about what one does as an artist and making paintings about that thinking. One of my more recent works that was there in the show recently, Artist in the Studio, what does he think about? The world outside, the world inside, his life, and this labyrinthine space. The space here, the walking from one room to another, to the balcony, looking out, turning back, looking into the house, walking back.